The Podski with John Baker. For over 1 year, the revolutionary force in audio entertainment.
Ooh, yeah!
Brother,
let me talk to you!
Freak out, freak out!
I just had an out-of-body experience!
Insane in the membrane!
Brother,
yeah!
And I'm here for only one reason, and that's to take it to the limit, yeah!
Somebody stop the damn man!
I'm living on the edge!
Who is your daddy? You take a mortal man.
Coming this Thanksgiving, who will win Booker of the Year? For the final time, the Podski and Hot Shots Wrestling presents WrestleMania. Coverage begins on the Podski YouTube channel and wherever you get your podcasts.
Hello and welcome to the Podski. I am your host, the man of a thousand gimmicks, Johnny Bake Show, episode 71. And we're back with the Podski 100. Today we're going to be doing 80 through 71. So if you haven't seen 100 through 81, you can catch that in the archives. We're going to be going over all of that as well. We got full crew here today. Not everyone is live. We're going to be piping in the other two jabrones, but we got Justin Andretti and I here. We're going to cover it, and we're going to talk about some things beforehand. But what's going on, Andretti?
I saw this Mexican guy today walking down the street with a mullet that had the sweetest New York Giants starter jacket that I have ever seen in my life. And it was just, he was in all his glory, dude. And it was just, when your team sucks and you're still rocking that gear and you're all in, dude, I love that so much. He was the man.
Oh yeah, I love that. I've done that way too many years. Speaking of that, if you want to catch out, if you're into that, we got That's So Dolphins Talk. We're going to be doing those every single post game. So we got a game review that'll be coming up. That we already got it this week. So yeah, we got a big one with the Chiefs this weekend. So that'll be a good one. That'll be before your wake up call. It's at 9:30 a.m. on the Eastern time. Good guys.
Oh, 9:30 Eastern.
Yeah, they're in Germany.
Why are they playing a game at 9:30 Eastern?
They're in Germany.
What's that?
They're in Germany.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, literally the game for the AFC top seed is going to be in Germany, not in America. At a home field, yeah, because wow. The Chiefs wanted to have the Bears game at home this year.
What do you know where they're playing in Germany? Where are they?
Munich, I think.
Munich, okay.
I'm pretty.
It's a great city. I got real drunk in Munich a couple times.
Really?
Oh yeah. Not even at Oktoberfest either, man. We were just over there. We went over there for our honeymoon, and we were on like a tour, and we were in Munich for a couple of days, and we stayed at this super expensive hotel. It started with a V. I forget the name of it, but they had like a full breakfast every morning with all these insane sausages. And I just was a complete glutton for probably 3 days straight, drunk out of my mind on at the Rathskellers, and then just eating sausages and croissants every day for as much as I could get. Dude, I would go back to Munich just to get that breakfast. I would fly to Munich to get that breakfast.
Just 100 sausages worth.
100 sausages. I would do it right now.
This is a good time for it's a good time in wrestling right now. I wanted to talk to you about like why is WWE seem to be like they're hot right now after literal years of dumpster fire. They finally have like figured it out and they're like on a big upswing and it doesn't seem to be slowing down at all. It seems to just be getting better and better every week. And then on the flip side, it seems like AEW can't do anything or get any traction. And it feels like we've already talked about this a few weeks ago when we did the AEW versus NXT show for the Title Tuesday show. But this just feels like it feels a little redundant that we're talking about it, but it feels important because what WWE has done in the last like calendar year and a half, like it just feels like they finally figured it out. I don't know what it took. I guess did it take, is it a difference of the leadership with Vince leaving and Triple H fully taking the reins, or is it creative decisions that have been because of the change, or is it the fact that they literally just figured it out and they finally turned Reigns heel, or is it all three of them together?
Well, I think it's all three. I mean, having Triple H be the head guy with the creative is a big deal. You know, he was running NXT when NXT was great. You know, a couple of years ago when they were just running excellent shows week in and week out. All the talent that you're seeing right now on the main roster are his people. You know, they're people that he brought into NXT or he wanted to bring into WWE that they developed, and they're now in those positions where they can be successful. I mean, you just take a look at the trajectory just of LA Knight. People, hey, it's a Triple H guy. You know, I mean, that's a guy that Triple H has wanted to bring in for a long time. He finally got him to come in, and now they're pushing him, and Vince wanted to destroy that guy. You know, I mean, there's countless of those. There's countless examples of those. I mean, Becky Lynch is arguably the number one women's wrestler ever. And, you know, Vince had her as a comedy goofball for a couple of years after she went away when she had the kid. You know, so, I mean, it's just a lot of that. There's a lot of people like that, that they just got trapped with Vince, and Vince just didn't see a vision for them. And then now Triple H is in charge, and they're kind of repackaging people a little bit, and they're covering up some of the mistakes that were made. I mean, Nakamura has proven that he's still a world-class talent, man. And Vince saw nothing in that guy, man, for a long time. I mean, you saw those matches he had with Rollins. He's fantastic. I mean, they made Rollins into a little bit of a geek too there for a bit. And he still dresses like a moron, you know, but he's one of the best wrestlers in the world. Yeah. And finally he's getting his shine. I mean, it's not a secret. I mean, when you've got, you know, Tyler Black was Triple H's guy. He's always been Triple H's guy, even from the ROH days. He was the guy Triple H really wanted to bring in. You know, they brought him in. He had an unbelievable career with Vince at the helm, but it kind of really trailed off there for a while, you know. And then they bring back the big gold belt, which is what it is. Mm-hmm. And Triple H puts the big gold belt on his guy. That's just an example. I mean, that's what it is, man. I mean, you've got a different guy in charge who is a new a new coach or a new GM or however you want to say it, that's bringing in his own players, and his players are starting to shine. And I'm not going to say it's perfect, because there's still some examples in there where, you know, people have kind of slipped away a little bit. Like, we haven't seen, what's the girl's name from Vegas? The one that was Zoe Stark. We haven't seen her in a couple of weeks. I don't know. Maybe she's injured. But, you know, I think, you know, that's kind of trailed off a little bit with her. But, you know, they're still, I don't know why they haven't pulled the trigger yet on the Street Profits thing with, you know, splitting them up and making, you know, for the single star. I'm not sure why they haven't done that yet. But, you know, there's plenty of time. There's plenty of time for that. But it really feels to me like we're potentially in a position right now where the WWE is going to be better than it's ever been in our lifetime. You know, top to bottom. I'm talking top to bottom, all the way from the bloodline storyline at the very top, all the way down to some of the stuff in NXT. That, all the way top to bottom, we're in a position right now where this could really be what it always should have been, which is really good storytelling, great matches. That's been the biggest gap that they've had for 20 years, maybe even more than that. Was just the fact that you can get better match quality outside the WWE, but Triple H is a match guy, you know, and it's like we're starting to see matches on Raw that are like, hey man, that was for that every single week we're saying it now. It's like, you know, hey, for that being a Raw match, that match was really good. Like, because we're comparing everything to what happened in over the last 20 years, right? Where matches were on TV, they didn't really matter at all, right? They were just out there to do their thing, 5-minute matches, whatever. But now we're seeing really good stuff every week on Raw and on SmackDown too, man. And I mean, hats off to them. I really hope they can keep it going, because this is a really exciting time to be a WWE fan.
Yeah, it's really funny that you mentioned that Tyler Black or Seth Rollins is a Triple H guy, because literally they crowned him the first NXT champion at that first NXT like pay-per-view. So
I didn't even think about that. But yeah, you're right.
And they literally came out and crowned him, like that really speaks volumes. And then, you know, fast forward that he was the guy that, you know, cashed in at the end of that WrestleMania 31, and then, you know, he had the WrestleMania match with Triple H. I'm pretty sure he has Triple H's last WrestleMania, or no, he doesn't have Triple H's last WrestleMania match, but like a big one. I mean, any WrestleMania match with Triple H is a big one, especially for a guy that he got hurt and he was like kind of lost in the shuffle a little bit there for a lot of years. And now that he's like the guy, like, yeah, like I love that he wears the ridiculous outfits. It's incredible. I love it. But it's nice that, like, another guy, Shinsuke Nakamura, he was like the king of the mountain in NXT, and he was the guy that everybody wanted to watch for that. And he really got lost in the shuffle whenever Vince was there too. Like, Vince,
look, it goes even down from that, because look at, I mean, this might be the best stuff Drew McIntyre's ever done in his career, and he's not even a champ, you know? So right. This might be some of the best stuff he's ever done, if not the best. I love what they're doing with that guy, man. He's Batman. They've made that guy Batman, you know, and it's really great. But I mean, look at the praise that we're getting from, like, you know, Ivar, you know, the guy from War Raiders. I mean, yeah. he got all that praise for being in those singles matches. I mean, they were dead in the freak of water, man. They were doing matches with Street Profits. And I think it was at WrestleMania where they were throwing bowling balls at each other in the street or something like that. Like, dude, yeah. Like they, you know what? Vince saw two guys that he thought were out of shape. He couldn't do anything. He tuned them out, man. He tuned those guys right out, man. But like, thankfully they're getting a little bit of a push right now. And hopefully they'll end up being something, because look, are they my favorite tag team in the world of 2023? No, they're not. Were they awesome 3 years ago? Yeah, they were great 3 years ago. Right. But I mean, they've got a lot to offer, man. And they look so different than everybody else did. It's almost like Vince kind of lost the plot on that, about the uniqueness of people, right? Because we're going to get into, I don't even know if I want to say this right now, but we're going to get into Mystico, you know, today, whenever we get into these next 10 with the top 100, and how that was a unique guy that came in. It was a major star that they took everything from that guy, man. And the guy just went into the toilet mentally. And it's like, of course he did. You know, I mean, like, yeah. That's the thing. But like, there's so many of those people that have come through the WWE, which is why, you know, guys like the Young Bucks and Omega and stuff like that shied away from going there, because they didn't want to get everything taken from them. And they wanted to be unique, and they wanted to do their thing. And hats off to them for that, man. Hats off to them for wanting to do their own thing and not go somewhere where they're going to get pigeonholed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and then back to your Street Profits thing, I'm pretty sure they got a new theme song with Bobby Lashley. So they've been with Lashley for the last couple of weeks. I'm a little behind. I haven't got a chance to watch this week's SmackDown, and I'm really excited for Raw tonight. I think that there's a pretty good Raw match. I can't remember what I saw, but yeah, I mean, like, just, you're 100% right. This is everything that we've wanted to see for a number of years, and what it always should have been in terms of WWE and in the main roster. Like, the NXT is supposed to be the feeder system, and for years NXT was like the shining star of WWE, and then as soon as they got called up to the main roster, it was nothing. And now these people are getting showcased on the main roster, and then you can go back to NXT where they're still doing that. And it seems like NXT, it's not the level that it was whenever Triple H was running it, but Shawn Michaels is trying to make it just as good.
It's a little different. It's good in certain ways. It's definitely different than what it was then. Because back then it was a lot darker and a lot more serious, you know. And right now it's a lot more colorful, a little more user friendly, I think, to people who just stumble across it on TV.
Right. And speaking of color and people stumbling across it, they've beat AEW 3 of the last 4 weeks in the ratings. Like, NXT was not doing that for a long time. Like, AEW dominated the space, and yeah, they did go head to head a couple weeks back, and yes, NXT did load the show with a ton of talent, but AEW,
Tony would have done the same thing, man. If Tony Khan had the Undertaker, and he had freaking, you know, Dusty Rhodes or whoever the hell it is, I mean, he would have put all those people on those shows,
right? And it didn't, it hasn't worked. And they, it seems like they can't catch their footing. It seems like everything that they do, like, yeah, they're doing this. The sad part is that the only thing that they've done right over all of these years is that they've booked the way that they've booked Sting as a legend is the best thing that they've consistently done over time. And then they bring out Ric Flair last week. And I don't know. I don't even know if that even helps. It's cool that Rick is on like TBS again after all these years. Like, that's cool. I just, and the fact that like Andrade's there, but like, I don't know. I never see Andrade anymore. At least I never see him on Dynamite. I feel like I never see him on Dynamite.
He's on Collision.
Okay. Fair enough. I mean, there's the things that AEW are doing, like the, after all of that stuff that happened with Punk and just everything, like, it's just left a sour taste in my mouth. And then everything with like Tony just bitching all the time about WWE and what they do to him. And he's like trying to, in a way, he's trying to pull the old Vince card that Vince pulled on Bischoff when Bischoff was pulling all of these stunts on Vince in the late 90s, whenever Nitro started. Is like, well, they've had all these years head start, they got all these stars, they got all this money and influence and all that, and I'm just a billionaire son and I'm doing an upstart company. And it's like, I don't know, it just doesn't, I don't know. I from where AEW was when we first started like watching, and you know where this podcast started a year ago, like it's really taken a huge hit. And I don't know if it's, I 100% want to blame it on Tony. I also want to blame it on the booking. And it's just, they've gone away from, I don't know. Tony has said a lot. Tony, these are Tony's words. These aren't mine, but he's literally said, I do not care about the weekly shows anymore because you all will buy the pay-per-views and we will always deliver on pay-per-view. Like, I like to follow this. I like, personally for me, I love to follow the stories. Like, I love to go on Peacock and I love to start a Raw and I love to watch it till, you know, like the end of the year. I love doing that. I do that all the time. And like, Dynamite was like the show I watched every single week. I used to make Allison sit with me while I watched Dynamite every Wednesday night. And I can't tell you the last time I sat down and watched an entire Dynamite from start to finish. I literally can't remember it. Like, it's been months. And it's frustrating. It just feels like they don't. And now I know that on the flip side of things, that like Mongoose will come in here and tell you that everything is great about AEW. Everything that they do is fantastic. And yeah, they have some hiccups here and there, but pretty much like they have awesome matches. And I'm sure that they do, but like, I just can't get into it anymore. I don't want to be an AEW hater, but because I was on the train from the beginning, but they threw me off the train and I've been on WWE for a while now. And it feels like more and more people are doing that.
My biggest gripe with AEW, I mean, outside of the fact that I feel like the owner and the CEO or GM or whatever the hell his title is a little kid. I mean, outside of that, the women's division for me is a big deal. I mean, I'm a big women's wrestling fan. I work with student athletes every day. You know that, man. And it's just like women's athletics to me is a big deal. It's about access. It's about opportunity. It's about equal opportunity. And they should have equal opportunity as the WNBA should, as women's soccer, as women's wrestling. I mean, you want to give the next generation of students and the next generation of kids people to look up to, right? And it's a constantly evolving thing where you ramp it up into equality, right? Over the course of time, right? Because if you don't flip a switch and make someone just love the WNBA, right? Or love college softball, right? You've got to kind of like integrate them slowly over time to get them to understand how important this stuff is, right? And how it is really good. And if you're looking at, you know, the WNBA versus the NBA, right? Of course, your natural instinct is going to say that the NBA is way better, you know, than the WNBA. But if you look at the WNBA in a vacuum about what it is itself, and again, like going back to the Mystico thing, what we're going to talk about, like the vacuum, right? CMLL in the vacuum is so awesome and so special to watch, dude. And it's the same thing as it is kind of with women's sports too. Like, you watch those Stardom shows and they are freaking lights out, dude. There are women on those shows that are just world-class wrestlers, men or women, dude. And that's what it is. So when I see this, and I'm just going to call it what it is, man. It's been garbage. It has been a garbage women's division for a while now in AEW. And I mean, that I don't want to call anybody out just for it being their own fault, because it's not any one person's fault. But that match from Dynamite with Ruby Soho and Sheeta was one of the worst matches I've ever seen on TV. It was, I mean, dude, I don't know what the hell is going on with some of these people. If they just don't want to work anymore, or they just don't give a shit, or what it is. But you have to give an effort when you're out there, and you know, you have to book effort. You've got to put people out there that are going to want to be out there, man. And you and I have talked about this a lot over the course of time. And I know I've talked to Mullen Goose for 100 years about this. Don't offer it unless you're going to try to be the best at it. Right. So don't offer a women's division unless you're going to try to have the best women's division in the world, right? Don't offer a tag team division unless you're going to put a full effort into that tag team division. And I fully believe that, man. And that maybe that's a personal philosophy of mine, where I think don't do anything unless you're going to put effort in, man. And I really believe that. Like, I'm not, you should want to be great at the things that you put effort into. And if you're going to offer two women's belts, and you're not going to try to bring in people that are the best in the world at what they do, and you're just going to throw people out there in bullshit matches and not care about it and not care about the booking. And I mean, they're getting criticized for it, man. And it's justified. There's shows where they have one women's match, or they have no women's matches, or they have one women's match on a pay-per-view. Like, when you do that, you're training your audience to think this is the piss break match, where you got to go get another Mountain Dew, or go get a bathroom, go get a hot dog, whatever you want to do during this match, because it doesn't matter. You've got to showcase it, and you've got to try. And that is where I have such a big problem with AEW, because they just throw everything at the wall, dude. Everything just gets thrown at the wall. Sometimes it sticks, and sometimes it's really great. The matches are usually really good. Almost every match is really good. It doesn't matter who it is, right? But there's so much stuff just thrown at the side of the wall, nothing, hardly anything is sticking right now, man. And they've just lost their way, is what it feels like. And it just feels like things are not going really anywhere. And I struggle to follow this, even though I watch their shows every week. I watch the pay-per-views. I struggle to follow this stuff, man. And I don't know what it is, other than them just getting some kind of a reboot. And I thought they did that. I thought they already did that, you know, with the reboot a couple pay-per-views ago, where they flipped a couple belts and it was like, okay, here we go. We're going to start over and do different things. But dude, this is the worst it's been, for sure. In the 44 or 5 years they've been around, this is the worst.
And it feels like they have showcased the women. And it's just the fact that when they do showcase the women, it ends up being an absolute train wreck. Like, I know that they put on some of those matches like early in the early years, and like that one with Nyla Rose and Statlander at that Revolution, that was awful. And it feels like they just, like,
Statlander isn't great, dude. She's pretty good. She's really strong. She's got a great look. People like her, but she's not great. She's just okay. And that's part of it too, is like, people are getting exposed a little bit, because here's the biggest difference between when you watch NXT's women's division, who are all green as hell. We all know that. Mm-hmm. Almost all those girls are very green, right? The speed of those women versus the AEW women's division, dude, it's like night and day. It is so much closer to stardom than what it is closer to anything else. Like, that the NXT women's division, when they are in the ring, there's movement, and they're going fast, and they're doing moves, and it's exciting. That's what people want to see nowadays. Now, I heard Kevin Nash say something a couple weeks ago, maybe a couple months ago, about him talking to Sean, about him talking to Michaels, and Nash even said, is like, dude, because Nash doesn't watch it every week. I'm sure he doesn't watch it. But, you know, he said, hey, man, that people are going way too fast. They got to slow it down in the ring. And Michaels told him, is like, dude, if they go in there right now and try to do a test of strength, everybody in that building is going to stand up and walk out. Because that's what we're accustomed to, right? We're kind of – and look, isn't that the Young Bucks style? That's what they got. Like, the Young Bucks are the ones that did that. Like, they're the ones that go 100 miles an hour every match. And people were so pissed off at them for that. Well, now those are the guys that have kind of influenced this whole women's division in another company, right? It's kind of what it is. So, I mean, I think a really important thing to say is that just, like, the difference in just speed. And it's not even match quality, because – the wrestling in the AEW women's division at the top is obviously better than it is at the top of the NXT women's division, right? The technical wrestling is better. But when you're talking about exciting matches and seeing people flying around and doing stuff and getting excited about characters, excited about, you know, just technique and different styles and things like that. I mean, dude, it's not even close between the two right now.
Yeah. That's funny that you say that about, like, what bothers me is that, like, a lot of those people that were in WWE and working with the women and that women's division, they're at AEW, and I don't understand where's the disconnect there. Is it just because WWE got rid of everybody that didn't matter, and, like, did they make the right calls? And, like, because you feel like it would translate over, and that, you know, AEW would want to do the same things that NXT is doing, and they just don't, and it's super frustrating.
Well, look, man, the two women that were in that women's breakout tournament, the finalists were people that were very predictable. It was Kalani Jordan and Lolo Vice. So Kalani Jordan was doing that program with Dana Brooke, where they were going to split them up, and she was going to get the big win over Dana Brooke, right? Well, then Dana got released, right? So, but Kalani Jordan has only been wrestling for probably a year. I don't know how long Lolo Vice has been there in the Performance Center, but she's an MMA. She came from MMA. And I'm telling you right now, man, the two of them right now being green are better than everybody in AEW, all the women, minus the very top. When you're talking about, like, Britt Baker, Toni Storm, maybe Hayter is probably in that group too, but those two women from NXT who were green are, I'm telling you, man, maybe this will change in a couple of weeks when I see more people's matches and they step up, but I would take Kalani Jordan and I would take Lola Vice right now over everybody else that's in that division, man. Other than Britt Baker and Hayter and probably Toni Storm, and that is very telling. That is very telling. When you got people that don't have that many matches under their belt and they're in there and they're that good and that quick already, dude. I mean, come on. Look at Tiffany Stratton. I mean, she's only been there for how long? She had two incredible matches with Becky Lynch. Now, look, Becky's going to make everybody look good. We all know that. But, you know, I mean, the fact that she's made a star out of Tiffany Stratton. If Tiffany Stratton showed up right now on the main roster, she'd be one of the biggest women in the company. You know, and that's the truth. You know, but you're playing silly games over there with Julia Hart. Bless her heart, no pun intended. You know, I mean, she's gotten way better. She has gotten way better.
Yeah.
But Julia Hart in NXT, she's not going to make it. She's not going to cut it. I love Willow Nightingale. There would always be a place for Willow Nightingale anywhere where I'd ever book, ever, forever. There'd always be a place for her. But you're playing silly games with Sky Blue. It's like, dude, come on, man. There's people out there that you've got to go get. You've got to go find people and bring in women that want to be showcased. Because right now, they're just not doing it.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, it's really sad that this is kind of like the it's like the roles have completely flipped on us. But yeah, so.
The idea behind this was to do a kind of a Podski-wide event and try to get as many people involved in this that have been on the show as possible. And since all of us have so much different perspectives on things and have different a different outlook on different things and different generations and international talent and whatnot, I really wanted to pull this together and have a top 100. But there were some requirements around that. So we started the top 100 with Hogan beating the Iron Sheik in 1984, in January of 1984. And we use that as the starting point because everything after that is different than everything before it. that was the beginning of the very beginning of sports entertainment when Vincent Kennedy McMahon got his guy Hulk Hogan, put the belt on Hulk Hogan. It started to transcend into WrestleMania One a year later, 2 years later, a year and a half, whatever. To rock and wrestling is what it ended up becoming, right? Where it became a cultural sports entertainment phenomenon that took off from there. And that was a good benchmark, I thought, to use, because everything that came before that was very different, very territory based. Vincent J. McMahon, you know, when he had everything, it was, even the WWF was a regional territory. And he probably would not have been super happy with what his son was planning on doing with sports entertainment. So that's a really good place to start, I thought. Now, what we also did not want to do is include people in this top 100 that had the bulk of their career, the prime of their career, prior to Hogan beating the Iron Sheik. So there's a lot of people that we're going to give some acknowledgments to here that probably should not be included in this list, because here's a perfect example. To grade Jerry Lawler based on his WWF run post 84 is probably not very not very fair to him, right? To grade Harley Race on being the king and not the stuff he did before 84 is not very fair to him. So we decided to disclude those people from this list and start with everything right when Hogan won the belt in 84. We tried to also keep tag team guys off of this list. So if it was somebody who the bulk of their career was involved in tag teams, we tried not to include them. We tried to keep this just as singles. And we also didn't include women in this list either. And we're going to do a women's list in the future, at some point, and probably tag teams too at some point. So we wanted to keep this just for men's singles with what we were doing. So we had four people come together to give a list of a top 100 on their own. And we gave everybody the individual freedom to come up with their own criteria of how they came to their list. So it was myself, it was Baker, JC, and Mongoose all came up with their own criteria that they're going to talk about how they came to the conclusion of the top 100 for themselves. So then once we had those top 100s from all four of us, we came together with a point system and we gave everybody a number based on where they were in each individual list. So as an example, and this is just a number off the top of my head, if Shannon Moore, okay, was number one on somebody's list, they would get 100 points, okay? And if Jim the Anvil Neidhart was number 50 on somebody's list, they would get 50 points for that, right? And if in the number 100 person would get 1 point, right? So if that was Evan Courageous, right? at the bottom of the list, he's going to get 1 point from that. So where those people were at in everybody's 1 through 100, all four of us had a 1 through 100. We gave everybody points based on where they were in those four lists, okay? The most amount of points a person could possibly get would then be 400 points. So we took the top 100 points winners throughout the course of those four lists to create our combined list of 100.
So how I came up with my list, I took a list of 500 wrestlers and that was my baseline so that I kind of knew kind of where to start. And that way I could kind of dwindle down from there. And I kind of started, I knew I had a top 20 that I wanted for sure. And that top 20 drastically changed after I got my list of 100. And I had to take a lot in and a lot out, but I like to, the way I kind of graded people out was kind of where they were in the business, what they match quality, at least from what, I can remember watching a few matches and just kind of overall what they meant to the business and whether or not they should actually be on the list or not. Like when I think of somebody who is a top 100 wrestler, like do they actually deserve to be on that list? And that is based off of, accomplishments that they had, wrestling style, character work. I really kind of based a lot of mine off character work because I felt like that was a really big part of it outside of in-ring work. And that's how I came up with my list.
So for my 100, the measuring stick that I used first was the Wrestling Observer Hall of Fame. And the reason for that is that I believe that it is possibly the truest Hall of Fame that we have in sport. The NFL and the NBA Hall of Fames have become the Hall of Very Good. And the Baseball Hall of Fame has pretentious writers that either won't vote in somebody that should unanimously be voted in simply because they don't want him unanimously voted in. They will vote in people that have been involved in the steroid era without voting for other people that are significantly better players with or without drug suspicions. And so because of that, I do feel that the Observer Hall of Fame, made up of writers, made up of journalists, historians, current and former wrestlers. And it's also regional too. So you have what is to me the truest measuring stick of actual greatness in your sport. It's not easy to get to. If you look at the list of who is in the Observer Hall of Fame, it is literally a who's who. And not in the way that, you know, we could say that, yeah, Michael Jordan's a Hall of Famer. But, you know, I'm sure that Antoine Walker will be someday too, you know, and that's not happening in the Wrestling Observer Hall of Fame. Edge isn't in there. CM Punk isn't in there, at least not yet. Same for Edge. Randy Orton's not in there. Jake the Snake Roberts isn't in there. You know, there's a lot of people that you can look. Jim Helwig isn't in there. There's a lot of people you can look up and down and say, oh, these are the greatest of all time, and they didn't cut the mustard. And so you were not allowed to be ranked ahead of anybody in the Observer Hall of Fame in my top 40 or top 45-ish, I guess I should say, unless you were Will Ospreay or Roman Reigns, which will be first ballot Hall of Famers themselves. So that was where I started. So my first half of my list is all strictly Observer Hall of Fame guys. And then from there, what I did was I basically looked at people that I thought moved the needle. I thought that, you know, whenever you'd said about character development, whenever you'd said about ring work, of course, all those things count. But I also wanted to take a look and try to objectively say, so if I have a new guy, like a John Moxley, right, where does he compare to a Lex Luger? And the answer is way above. And the reason for that is that John Moxley, while he doesn't have the look that Luger did, he has everything else. He has the same, if not more, charisma. His promos to me are better. He's better in the ring. He's had a string of championships across multiple promotions. And he's a guy that has high match quality. And so just using that little comparison right there, that was sort of how I put everything together. Now, do I always have new guys ahead of old guys? Absolutely not. I have soft spot in my heart that I had to try to back off whenever, you know, ranking all of these people. But, you know, bringing objectivity into it was the most challenging thing because, you know, there are people that we all have our favorites and we all have our not favorites. And so it's really tough to say, guy that I never liked, and not because he's a heel, but like he didn't do it for me, is better than guy that I did. But hey, man, this is what making lists are all about. So this was a lot of fun, and that was how I put mine together.
So when I did my top 100, I broke everything out by six categories, and I ranked everybody 1 through 10 in each of the six categories. And one thing that really helped me when I was going through and putting the 1 through 10 grades in was I came up with a baseline. Where everybody was. So I found somebody who was kind of, you know, between 1 and 10, if they were a 5 or a 6, I would kind of use them as a baseline to see who was higher than them or who was lower than them based on the six categories. So the six categories I had, the first one I used was placement, and that was kind of where they were actually featured within the cards, right? Or over the course of time. In ring, obviously, was one of them. That's kind of actual talent, whether or not they look like they know what they're doing. Accomplishments, what they've done, of course, and that can be anything from observer awards to championships and multiple promotions, and whatnot, over the course of their whole career. The next one I had was legacy. And that was kind of what they meant to the industry, who they kind of inspired, kind of what their reputation was. The next one was length and consistency. And that was just kind of like a longevity thing to see kind of where were they over the course of time after the January of 84 timeline, if they were kind of, you know, still a high placement at that point. And then the last one I had was promotional importance, a little bit different than placement. Promotional importance is something, you know, to the effect of how important are they to the promotion, right? Are they somebody who's like the face of the promotion, or are they somebody who is like a workhorse in the promotion, or are they someone who just gets beat all the time and doesn't really matter, right? So those were the six categories that I had, and I gave everybody a ranking between 1 and 10. Most of the people were a 5 and above, because I wanted to keep it pretty, you know, pretty realistic. Anybody below a 5 really wouldn't even be on the list, right? But then I graded everybody, all the numbers up across the six categories into an overall score, and then filtered that, and then that gave me my my top 100 from there. But then I had ties. Obviously, I had people who had tied scores, and I had to go back in and kind of figure out what I wanted to use as a tiebreaker. And a lot of times I would just use accomplishments for that. Again, I'd look at their accomplishments versus each other. So if two people had like a 68, I would go in and look at both those people's accomplishments, and I would kind of just figure out from there who was going to be on top and who was going to be on the bottom of that. So that's how I came to my top 100 for myself.
All right. So, for my list, you took a very analytical approach, having listened to you talk about how you did yours. Mine was a little bit more organic, you being a little bit longer tenured of a fan than I am. I needed some help going through some names, so I looked up some general list of, you know, people they considered the top 100 of all time, you know, 84, you know, prior to 84, after 84. So there was some differences there, and then I tried to filter it all through my lens and into a tiering system. So I had like your S tier, your A tier, your B tier, your C, and D. And then I tried to establish like who I thought was the best of each tier, and then work around that. And the criteria that I used for that was popularity, so like their overall overness, or my perception of that, if it was something I wasn't as familiar with. The number, length, and general importance of their title reigns. Now that could be upper card, mid card, you know, that sort of thing. And some of them don't, you know, they might not have had any meaningful kind of title, but that plays into it. Longevity was a big one for me. So how long have they been doing it? Like, you know, and Austin was on top at a very hot time, but it wasn't a long run. And then general contributions I also thought were important. So I broke that down sort of by innovations they brought to wrestling. An example of this would be like the Ultimate Deletion. So that sort of thing that was the cinematic universe, those sort of things would be a little bit different. One thing I thought was very important was, especially for the top end guys, I put this in as a way to differentiate a little bit who they made, as far as, you know, the next star after them. And then just, you know, some general kind of stuff, like if they did, you know, if they headlined some kind of really crazy special show, or anything like that, if they were a booker at some point, those I took into consideration. Well, so as I went through there, I just tried to place similar talents in similar tiers, or people I thought were similar talents in similar tiers. And I tried to expand my list. Like, I had a list, but it felt skewed towards North American and like Attitude Era, Ruthless Aggression, and a little bit of today. I tried to back away from Stars of Today as much. So I went and tried to expand my reach a little bit and understand a little bit more of like Japanese stars of like the early, mid, and late 90s. And so in the early 2000s, some of those sort of things where I'm not as knowledgeable and intelligible. So I tried a little bit. It's going to skew towards what I know, and that is what it is. That's why these lists work, is different perspectives. But that was sort of how I ended up trying to. My sense, and then the tiering system, doing a little bit of research and trying to filter it all through those criteria.
We got the list today. We got the next round of 10. This is going to be 80 through 71 And so if you're on YouTube right now, you can check out on the screen who we've already done so far. It's 100 through 81. We can run over them real quick. We got Slaughter at 100, Masahiro Chono at 99, Rick Martel at 88, Kevin Sullivan at 97, Shane Douglas, Tomohiro Ishii, Matt Hardy, Ron Simmons, Kofi Kingston at LA Park were your first 10. And that was two episodes ago. So if you haven't watched that and you want to hear what we have to say about them and why they made the list, you can go check that out in the archives. And then for what we did the previous episode of the Podski 100, it was 90 through 81. And number 90 was Shinya Hashimoto. 89 was Davey Boy Smith. 88, Minoru Suzuki. 87 was Taz. 86, Drew McIntyre. 85, Kenta Kobashi. 84, Perro Aguayo. 83, Ricky Choshu. 82, Jay White. And 81, JBL. So.
You want to do a Podski special here right now real quick?
Yeah.
The dogs just went crazy because the mailman came.
Yeah.
They got a little package here. So let's do a little unboxing here. Let's see what we got here, Baker. Let's see what we got. So we're going to open this up. Oh, boy. Here we go. Live on the Podski. Here we go. Right here. Look at this.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, yeah.
That's incredible.
Look at how well this came out. So we got an Ultimo Dragon mask that I ordered because I found a styrofoam mannequin head at Hobby Lobby a couple weeks ago. It was $4. And I was like, well, shit, $4. I'll just buy an Ultimo Dragon mask and put it under there. So I got the Ultimo Dragon. I'm going to put this on right now, dude. So we got the light blue with the gold and the red. That came out pretty good. That came out actually really good. So I got it from a guy in Mexico that makes them. He makes them for wrestlers. So it was only it was on sale on eBay. I only paid like I think I only paid like $45 for it, something like that. So nice. It came out.
Well, if you're on the YouTube, you're gonna see this mask.
Let's see here. If I can get it on. A little tight. This might be for children.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, dude. How awesome is this? I know it clips somehow. Here's the clip. I don't know. I can't even get a clip. My face is too fat. I can't even get a clip.
Well,
I'm like Fatimo Dragon.
Thank you, Ultimo Dragon, for joining us on the Podski today. That mask is awesome.
You know, Ultimo Dragon mask with all the right moves poster, Steppin' George Mitch jersey in the back. Just like they do in Dragon Gate, dude. Just like they have in Dragon Gate.
Oh my, that's fantastic.
I'll tell you what, dude. I can't wait. You're gonna put this on YouTube?
Yep.
Okay, hold on one. Keep it rolling. I'm gonna show you. I'm gonna give you a little sneak peek of what I've been working on last night. Here, you wanna see part of the Halloween gimmick that's gonna be worn tomorrow night?
Sure.
All right, let me show you this.
That mask is fantastic.
Dude, check it out.
Is that the Bam Bam suit?
It's the shirt.
Oh, the Bam Bam shirt?
I'm still working on the pants. They're still drying, but here's the shirt.
That's awesome.
So I'll be getting pictures of that tomorrow night.
Justin Andretti will be live at a living color in the streets of Hollywood.
That's right.
The
Justice Bam Bam.
Justice Bam Bam.
With a beard that's with an Ultimo Dragon mask, you know, in a beard with a washable marker, a brown beard with a washable marker.
I was hoping you'd go as Ultimo Bigelow.
I mean, I might now. Why the hell not? Right?
Why not?
They both moved about the same. So they both do cartwheels. So I might as well do the damn thing. All right, I'm gonna take this off. This is already hot with this mask.
Yeah.
All right. Holy shit. That's tight. That's so badass.
I think it's sick.
Okay. Where are we at? What are we doing? Are we still doing the show?
Yeah, we're still doing the show. We're at coming in with our first entrant of the show, coming in at number 80 with 80 votes. He was on Mongoose's list at 90, and he was on Justin Andretti's list at 33. And that is Hiroshi Tenzan. So, what do you got for Tenzan?
Man, I love this guy. So, you know, when New Japan's a little different. So when you watch New Japan shows right now, you're going to get a lot of like six-man tags, eight-man tags, things like that, right? And there's always people thrown in there that kind of whip your ass a little bit, right? So you probably get like some of the older guys are in there that are like, holy shit, this guy, man. But Tenzan is a guy that is always in those matches. He's got an unbelievable look, you know, with the dual kind of mohawk thing, right?
Yeah.
But you know, you watch that guy now, and he's an old man, right? He's still in there doing his thing, and he's entertaining, but he's an old man. But I think people sometimes forget that they weren't always old men, right? At one point, they were like, you know, really good and on top of the world. And you know, Tenzan is one of those guys where he's still in there doing his thing, but he's, you know, I don't know why the hell the guy's still wrestling nowadays. But you know, when we're talking about like the early 2000s, mid 2000s, this is a guy that just was an ass kicker, man. I mean, he kind of, if you want to compare him to somebody, I guess you can kind of compare him a little bit to kind of being like the first great Okan, you know, where he's got the jump chops and stuff like that that look really great. Just a great offense, man. A great offense from that guy. You know, I think people kind of don't realize the importance that he had, you know, over the course of time. Also, you know, the thing about Tenzan, the American audience may kind of remember him from the fact that he wrestled Savage at Starrcade 95. Mm-hmm. I mean, people don't really remember that, but he had a really brief WCW run when they were bringing people in. And then he was another member of NWO Japan. You know, and he did a couple matches, you know, in WCW, but the bulk of his really good stuff, I think, was probably prior to that, in New Japan. But it, I mean, look, man, just a guy that has a great look, you know, an awesome offensive set, you know, and look, if you want to see something good from him, the Yuji Nagata match on New Japan World from January 4th, 2001. I watched that last night, which is really good. But there's a match. So he had two matches with Savage. So he had the Starrcade match with Savage in 1995. Go check that out if you want. But then he had another like a revenge match with Savage in New Japan. And I believe that's the one that's on YouTube. So if you want to, again, man, like we're just trying to give people, you know, a little bit of familiarity when we're giving them names that they might not be familiar with, right? So if you want to get kind of introduced to what Tenzan is like in a ring, go check out the Randy Savage matches, man. There's the Starrcade 95 and the one from the New Japan show. I believe that match is on YouTube. So if you want to go check that out, go ahead and check it out. Man, I don't think you'll be disappointed. You're going to see a guy in his prime that you see all the time right now as an old man. And that's it's you'll get a lot more appreciation whenever you see this guy working in his prime, for sure.
Yeah. And some other notable notes on Tenzan is that he was the IWGP heavyweight champion four times. He was the tag team champion 12 times. He won three G1s. He has a lot of, I mean, I didn't even realize he had,
I mean, he won three G1s in 4 years. So that's a big deal. When you think about that, that would be like somebody winning the Royal Rumble three out of 4 years.
Right. That's crazy. He also, for Observer Awards, he was tag team of the year in 2001 with Kojima. And he was a part of NWO, he was a part of the best gimmick and feud of the year for NWO.
Yeah. He kind of got, you know, London. Tag along with that, with those two awards. When we're talking about like the Tokyo Awards are big, right? With the Fighting Spirit Award 2004 is a big deal. That was right whenever he won the G1 that year, you know, on top of the world. And he had unbelievable matches, man. I mean, there's a great match with Tanahashi from that year. I think it's from 2004. Yeah, there's a really good Tanahashi match with him. And there's you know, great tag team. Look, I know we're trying to stay away from the tag team stuff, but it's worth mentioning when a guy is 12-time champ. You know what I mean? And he's had the belt with 25 different people, right? So I mean, it's worth just saying that. But I mean, there's a lot of really good stuff here to go back and check out with this guy.
Absolutely. All right, so we got coming in at number 79 with 81 votes. We got Kensuke Sasaki. And he was on Andretti's list at number 36. And he was also on JC's list at 85. So we'll have both of you guys talk about that.
I can't say enough good stuff about this guy either, man. I mean, he just when you think of a professional wrestler in your head, okay, what does a pro wrestler look like? You're going to probably see Kobashi, and you're probably going to see Sasaki. That's what it is, dude. If you just imagine in your head, what does a pro wrestler look like? Those are probably the two people whose body type you're going to see in your head. Now, look, again, I know we're not really trying to talk about, you know, accomplishments with tag team stuff, but it's worth mentioning whenever it's really important to a guy's career, right? You know, the American audience might know him from teaming with Hase, you know, when they took on the Steiners in the early 90s. I mean, those are incredible tag team matches to go check out if you want to get into some tag team stuff. But you know, he was the Power Warrior. A lot of people remember him as the Power Warrior too, when he was teaming up with Road Warrior Hawk, and sometimes even with Animal too, when they would do like trios matches. But I mean, that's a great character, man. I mean, he fits right in with the Road Warriors with the you know, the shoulder pads and everything. It's really cool to see that. So he was involved too for a little bit in MMA. I believe he was 2-0 in MMA, if I'm remember correctly from reading about that stuff. But one of the things I thought was really cool about Sasaki was the fact that he trained in the Heart Dungeon. And I didn't know that. I didn't know that he had been in he was in Stampede for a little bit when he went on excursion and got to work in the dungeon with Stu and whoever else at that point in time. That's pretty cool to see that. You know, when you see a guy that left Japan to go on excursion, he ends up in the dungeon in freaking, you know, Calgary. It's pretty awesome to see that.
Yeah, actually, he won.
I don't know why you don't really hear his name more. Whenever you hear about like the most important people in New Japan, you know, in Japanese wrestling history, I mean, I think it's probably because Sasaki kind of peaked right around the time when New Japan wasn't doing great, in my opinion. So it could be because of that. But the guy had a 30-year career, just a powerful ass kicker. You know, I mean, dude, that match with Kobashi. I mean, I know I said it last time when we went over, you know, Kobashi was in the top 100 last time. But that match with Destiny 2005 in Pro Wrestling Noah, it's on YouTube. It's free. It's maybe my favorite match I've ever seen in my life. I really, really got to just encourage people to go and check that out. And the other thing about Sasaki too, that we have to mention, you know, he's the first of five people to ever hold all three major heavyweight titles, right? He held the IWGP title, the Triple Crown Heavyweight Championship, and then in the Pro Wrestling Noah Championship, you know? So, I mean, that's a pretty impressive thing. And the other people were, you know, Muto was one of those. Kojima, who we've mentioned, you know, here, Yoshihiro Takayama is the other guy, and Nagata. You know, I'm sure we'll get to Nagata here at some point, but I mean, those are three or you know, four other people, pretty good company to be in, right? If you've won all three of those major titles in Japan, man, I mean, again, like when you picture a pro wrestler in your head, what does a professional wrestler look like? It's probably going to be a beefy guy that's strong as shit that looks a hell of a lot like Sasaki. So that is an important thing. This guy had a great career. I mean, he's a lot of fun to watch.
Yeah, and so what you had mentioned about him and his accomplishments, he was 2-0 in MMA. He won both of them by submission. And
nice.
The first one was 36 seconds, and the second one was 2 minutes and 35 seconds, both in the first round.
Nice.
So clearly Stu got in there. Yeah, grab.
Stu taught him everything. I mean, that's, you know, gotta get in there and stretch him.
Yeah, stretch him. Jeez. So yeah, he won the IWGP championship five times. He was tag team champion seven times, won two G1s, 97 and 2000. We're not going to mention the PWI. We already talked about how much of a gimmick that is and how crappy that whole thing is. But he had match of the year in the Observer Awards in 1991. And he was inducted into the Hall of Fame in 2013. So pretty accomplished guy. I mean, literally, if you look at all of his accomplishments, like he wrestled everywhere, like, especially whenever he was on excursion, like he went everywhere. Like, it's,
yeah.
Yeah.
So I think also worth mentioning, the Tokyo Sports Awards are probably worth mentioning for some of these guys. So Lifetime Achievement Award from them, 2014. Mm-hmm. Two-time Match of the Year. He had the 2000 Match of the Year with Toshiaki Kawada, and then in 2005 with Kobashi, which is, you know, you gotta see it. Wrestler of the Year, 2004. Probably worth noting here, too, the fact that he was the U.S. Heavyweight Champion in WCW. And yeah. I don't know what happened, but he lost that belt to the One Man Gang. And he's one of my favorites, but I don't know. Dude, I watched it. I found that match probably a year ago, and it's not very long. And it's just like, I don't know what happened. I don't know what the scenario was behind that, where he lost that belt to the gang, you know, really quickly in a match. It's very strange, but look, it is what it is, you know, but he still won the belt. You know, he still was the U.S. heavyweight champion. If an American audience is interested in checking that out, you know, with the WCW stuff. But other than that, man, you know, just a hell of a worker, man. And a super strong, great to see that guy in the ring. I mean, he performed with a lot of really great people over the course of time, and he's won a lot of stuff. And it's definitely a guy, you know, I know we're talking about a lot of Japanese guys, a lot of international talent. We're trying to, you know, give them a shine here too when we're doing this 100, but we're giving you people that we think you need to investigate and people that you should investigate. If you're a wrestling fan, you should know who these people are, and you should go out of your way to check them out, because they were a big deal to history. And you want to go and you want to be a student of history, be a student of this industry, because it is really fun to investigate these guys.
Yeah, agreed.
Sasuke is one of those guys who I didn't know a ton about, but in trying to expand my horizons, I learned a bit about him and why he's, you know, deserves to be on this list. I really looked at it and I saw that he's in that class of the heralded Japanese wrestlers of his era. Worked at all the major promotions in Japan at the time, 5-time IWGP heavyweight champion, 7-time tag champion, held all of the major heavyweight titles over there. He was even a WCW US champ. There was a crossover kind of show. Observer Hall of Famer, had a great match of the year, I think 1990 or 1991. But he's just one of those guys, just one of the top guys in Japan of that era.
Moving on to number 78 with 82 points. He was on two of our lists. He was on my list at 49, and he was on JC's list at 71, and that is Sean Waltman. So, personally, my introduction to Waltman was whenever he was X-Pac, whenever he came back and was part of DX, and I think that we can all agree that while we're not talking about tag teams and factions and all that, he was in the two biggest factions in the Attitude Era. He was a part of NWO and D-Generation X. And his movement from WCW back to WWE, him coming back as being like on the Raw after WrestleMania, and him being showcased right after one of the biggest, well, the biggest WrestleMania. WrestleMania 14 is one of the best. If you want to go back and watch that, it's one of the best WrestleManias you'll ever see. And for him to be showcased by Triple H bringing him out, that was a really big moment. And that's not the biggest, like, I don't think that's his biggest moment for him career-wise in WWE. I feel like, you know, whenever he came in as the 1-2-3 kid on those initial Raws against Razor Ramon and doing all that, like, that's like really good stuff. Like, Razor Ramon made him that night, and you know, he kind of went on. I think that, you know, he has a lot of innovative stuff. Like the Bronco Buster is a really cool move. I thought that he did a lot of good stuff for that cruiserweight lightweight division. I just think that, you know, he really needed to be mentioned here. You know, he has all kinds of matches that, you know, you probably should check out too. And you know, he did a lot of he's literally worked everywhere. So outside of the stuff that he's done in WWE, he kind of had a career resurgence in the around the 2013-14 era. He started making a comeback on all of these independents, and He's been like literally working. He got into incredible shape, and you know, he's made a couple appearances for these, some of these shows. I think he was in a couple Royal Rumbles over the last couple of years as well. Not like super recently, but you know, he went into the Hall of Fame with DX, and that was in 2019 for WrestleMania 35, I believe. I mean, he just, you think about the Attitude Era, and one of the first faces you think that, like, if you were to put faces and people that you think about when you think about Raw in the Attitude Era, you think about DX and you instantly think about Sean Waltman or X-Pac. Like, he's instantly one of the most recognizable faces you think about. So that's why he was so high on my list. And but yeah, I just think he was great.
I don't know why he didn't make mine. I think he was around like 105 whenever I finally broke down my whole, he just didn't get into the top 100. But so my first introduction to 123 Kid, I mean, you're probably not even gonna believe this, but before school, when I was in high school, especially when I was like a freshman, maybe even eighth grade, ninth grade, 10th grade, I used to watch USWA wrestling in the mornings before school, and they would run reruns. I don't know what the hell channel it was on, man, but I would wake up real quick and shower, run downstairs, and while I was eating or waiting for the bus or, you know, waiting to leave for high school, I would catch maybe an episode or maybe even two episodes of USWA. And I loved USWA at the time. And Waltman was in there, dude. He was the Lightning Kid in USWA. And I swear to you, this is the truth. I saw that guy wrestle one time on USWA, and I was like, holy cow, this guy, right? Super fast in the ring. You know, everything looked just unbelievable for him. He was moving at a pace at that point that just nobody was moving at in the United States, right? In North America. Maybe, I mean, probably Mexico, but not the US, but I mean, just unbelievable. And then when he showed up in WWF, you know, as a 123 Kid, I was like, oh my God, I know that guy. Like I saw that guy wrestle in USWA, you know, a couple of years ago. But you know, I really liked him as the 123 Kid. I think part of that, you know, part of the lore of him too, is the Hasbro figure that is unattainable, right? I mean, so that's the only one I don't have. It's the only Hasbro I don't have is a 123 Kid. And I'm never gonna drop $1,000 on that figure. It's just never gonna happen. But and I'm okay with that. I've made my peace with it over the course of time. But I mean, you know, with all the stuff right now with 3D printers, maybe somebody will make a fake one and I can just get it and just to have it, right? But he was a guy that just an unbelievable cruiserweight, super fast. People, for whatever reason, like right there in the early 2000s, hated that guy, man. And I'm not sure what do you remember why? Like why did everybody just turn on that guy so hard?
He had Waltman did have some demons, and this is like supposed to be like a career spotlight and what we're supposed to talk about, but I know that they talked about it on Bruce a lot, where he was a classic bag shitter, where he would shit in people's bags. And I think
that's probably not a good thing.
Yeah. And I know that like they did a whole show. Like if you want to hear more about Waltman, like I'm pretty sure that Bruce on Something to Wrestle with Conrad, I know that, you know, shout out to them. I know that some people don't always like Conrad, but they did a whole career retrospective on Waltman. That was a pretty good show from what I remember. And they talked about like how like, he was kind of a shithead backstage.
Sure. You know, a lot of people were, you know, but look at, I mean, you can't deny the guy's accomplishments and his ability. I mean, that, the match with Hart that was on Raw, I think I wrote it down. When was that?
I think I know which one you're talking about.
July 11th, 1994 on Raw. Dude, I mean, top 10 for me, no question about it. I mean, just what a match. That might be maybe the best match in Raw history, man. I don't know. It's definitely up there. That's for sure. That match is unbelievable. So if you're looking for a match to check out from him in the 123 Kid days, man, go watch that Bret Hart match from July 11th, 94 on Raw, man. You're definitely not going to be disappointed when you watch that thing.
Agreed.
So what do we got here for accomplishments for X-Pac?
Oh yeah, sorry. We got he was Observer stuff wise, he's lumped in with the NWO stuff. But for WWE, he was European champion two times. He was the two-time and the final light heavyweight champion. He's a cruiserweight champion, four-time tag team champion. Really funny that he was, I feel like I mentioned this whenever I was in a show with JC, whenever he was in a tag team with Marty Jannetty, and they had that one match. I can't remember who they had it against on Raw. I was hooked. They had me hook, line, and sinker because I redid that new gen like watch through at the beginning of the year whenever I got some of that new gen figures with Macho. And then I ended up getting the remake of that 1-2-3 kid from that Raw 30 set that was a Target exclusive. I loved that tag team for some reason. Like, they were awesome. He won Biggest Heart Slammy Award in 1994. He won the WWF Tag Team Championship Tournament with Bob Holly, and he's a two-time Hall of Famer, as mentioned earlier, with DX and NWO.
Also, it's kind of interesting to think that guy was only the WCW Cruiserweight Champion one time. I know there was a lot of talent there, but they were really pushing him. I mean, he was an NWO guy. You'd think that he would have had had that belt a couple more times, but I guess he would have left, right, to go to the WWF Attitude Era at that point, right? Kind of towards the end of the 90s.
I'm pretty sure. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so too. But also probably worth noting here with Waltman, he was the Bad Boys of Wrestling Federation Caribbean champion. So hats off to you for that. And also the Great Lakes Championship heavyweight champion. So
and he also he was at GCW in 2022. He tagged with Janela for Janela Spring Break.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, good stuff, man. Hats off to that guy, man. What a career. For the time that he was around, man, there just was nobody working at that speed. And you go back and watch that guy now, he's just flying around like a freaking maniac, dude. It's awesome.
Yeah. One thing that, you know, I think he was really close to going into an NXT match whenever Triple H was running it back in like 18, 19, but nothing ever came of it. But yeah, it was, I think he might've been close at one point to pulling a trigger on that, but super happy for that guy. Love that he made the list. And
I didn't know he was X Division champ. I didn't know that he was TNA X Division champ one time.
Yeah. I think he had a short run with NXT or I'm not a TNA.
So whether you know him as the 1-2-3 kid, Six-Pac, X-Pac, Sean Waltman is one of those people who was there at a great time. He was I don't know that he was ever a top guy, but he was in league with the top guys, in the top factions. At one point, he was kind of the gatekeeper. He gave you the thumbs up or the thumbs down if you were ready to go. He was always around in the hottest era, and maybe wasn't the top act, but he was, you know, he reminds me of the definition of a good hand. So I think there's something to be said for that for him. Some of the big matches, you know, the 1-2-3 kid moniker came from him getting a surprise win over Razor, in the early 90s. But yeah, he was with the NWO. He was with DX. He was a short time in TNA. And I think as a human, he's pretty well liked overall. He was he had some demons, and he seems to have come away on the other side pretty good with them. So definitely think that in the grand scheme of everything, he's a really good worker and did some innovative stuff for his time.
Oh, all right. Well, moving on to number 77 with 85 votes. He came in at number 40 on Mongoose's list, and he came in at 77 on your list, Andretti. So, and that is Mystico.
A lot of stuff you can say about this guy, man. I mean, what an up and down career that it's, you know, he's going to be one of those guys that when he hangs it up finally, you know, down the road, when people start writing books about this guy, it's going to be really interesting. He's going to be a really interesting guy to cover historically down the road. I mean, he's the only luchador to ever win the Wrestling Observer Newsletter Wrestler of the Year Award. He's the only luchador to ever do that. And it's crazy. You know, this guy, I mean, if we try to do this just chronologically, I mean, an enormous draw, man. Enormous draw. I mean, he maybe one of the biggest draws in the world for almost a decade at that point, from 2000 to 2009. I mean, his run, just unbelievable run, man. And again, like, when you see these people in the vacuum, right, and what they mean to that area or that promotion of CMLL for him, it's selling out, man, all the time. People love this guy. He's still moving tickets. I mean, they had that show, the AEW show in Houston, and the guy moved like 3,000 or 4,000 tickets, you know, just by announcing that Mystico was going to be on that card. That's a big deal. That's a big deal to think about that. But, you know, it's crazy because he's such a victim of going into WWE at the wrong time, right? Where you go there and they just strip everything from you, right? And they turn you into what they want you to be, and they take away the character and all that stuff. His WWE run is crazy, man. He's in there as Sin Cara. The guy just immediately looks like he don't give a fuck, right? He's in there. He's just, you know, and look, these are other people's words. They're not mine. You know, people are saying the guy's not putting in any effort. He's lazy, you know, yada, yada. I mean, there's certainly clips of it, you know, with him, you know, not putting in much effort, and, you know, abrasive, I think, too, you know, backstage, and just a guy that just, you know, for whatever reason, it just didn't work. And they punished him for it, man. And they really did. They punished him for it. And then the guy just, I mean, that was a major, major signing for WWE when they brought him in. And I remember everybody thinking that was going to be a huge deal, and that guy just shit the bed, man. And it hurt him big time. It really hurt him big time. Because then he went back to Mexico, wrestling as Carlistico, right? Which was kind of a play on his Mystico name. But the guy right now, Drolistico in AEW, who people probably know from the AEW run, but he's also a Mexican wrestler, obviously. He actually was Mystico 2 in Mexico whenever Mystico 1, which is Sin Cara, was Sin Cara, right? So I know it gets a little confusing sometimes with the Lucha Libre stuff, but, you know, when Mystico went back, Drolistico gave him the name, right? So then that guy became Drolistico, and then Mystico became Mystico. So look, I know it's a little confusing, but, you know, it's a big deal. The names in Mexico are a big deal. The masks are a big deal, you know. So for him to go back to that character was really an important thing for him. And I think it kind of just reinvigorated that guy, man, because this is a guy that's got world-class talent. He always has. But up and down career, man, you know, the speed, again, I know we're talking about speed with, you know, the NXT women and Waltman and whatnot, you know, kind of being a theme here. I didn't even expect that, but kind of being a theme, just the speed, the agility with him, the high flying. I mean, the guy just, even now at 40 years old, is just, he's on top of the world, you know. And sometimes I think just sometimes, man, when you see these guys in that environment, you know, in their particular environment, it can be kind of hard to measure them and what they mean to that environment, you know. And sometimes when they leave that environment and it doesn't fit, it just doesn't fit. I mean, you take a look at like the WCW stuff, right? When ECW was running those shows in small arenas, and the crowd is just insane, right? And people are throwing stuff in the ring, and it's a big deal. And you feel like you're a part of something when you're at those shows, right? And then WWE buys ECW. They put ECW into arenas, and it just doesn't fit. It just doesn't fit, right? It doesn't work. It doesn't work in that environment, right? And that's kind of, I think that's maybe part of some of the things that happen to these luchadors. They're such big stars in that environment that when they step out of it, maybe it's just not the right fit. I mean, I think, you know, maybe a way to look at that too, you know, we're measuring wrestlers that are from all these different promotions, but not all those promotions are equal. You know, they're all unique, and they all stand out in their own individual way, right? So when you look at people that play football in the CFL, right? The CFL's got different rules. They've got their own stars, right? They've got all these badass, you know, stars in the CFL. I mean, it's hard to measure what that guy's accomplishments is versus somebody that plays in the NFL, or, you know, versus somebody that plays in the, maybe somebody's really good in the USFL in that environment, right? Or even NFL Europe, something like that. Like, all those people matter, and they all matter in that vacuum that they exist in. And sometimes when they leave that or go from, you know, one environment to another, maybe it just doesn't translate over. And I really think that that's kind of what it is with the luchadors that end up coming to the United States, you know, from Mexico. And also the fact that the rings are different, dude, especially the ropes are different. I mean, everything is different. You got to learn a new style is what it is when you go to WWE. And I think Mystico is probably a victim of that, like a lot of others have been over the course of time. But when you look at that guy just in that arena Mexico environment, dude, and you see those people going crazy, and he's a big time star for them, man. It's just so awesome. It's so awesome to watch it and just immerse yourself in what it is. Just love what it is, man, and watch what it is. If you just keep your focus on what it is. And if you can do that, you're gonna have an unbelievable time watching wrestling, and you're gonna see that this guy is a major deal and a major star and a big draw and somebody that is absolutely deserving of being the wrestler of the year for sure.
Yeah, some accomplishments that you already mentioned were biggest for Observer stuff. He was best box office draw, best box office draw of the decade, best flying wrestler, and wrestler of the year. And Observer Hall of Fame in 2022. And I just know that for myself that, you know, Mystico, I didn't even know that that's who it was. I just know him as Sin Cara. So, like, I just don't, no one really cared about Sin Cara in WWE. So, like, that's what sucks is, like, when you go, when stuff doesn't fit and you go outside of, you know, your home base and you take the big WWE stage, it can engulf you. And that's kind of what it seems for that guy. And that sucks.
Yeah. I mean, he was also IWGP Junior Heavyweight Champion one time, too. Here's a testament to him. I mean, for the match that I think people should go check out, is the Templario match. And that match happened 2 weeks ago. I mean, that guy's 40 years old. He put on, him and Templario put on like a 4.5, 5-star match like 2 weeks ago, man. It's just, go find it. Go find that match. You can watch the highlights on YouTube. Even if you just watch the highlights, you're going to see that these guys were in there just killing it, right? Templario was really good, too. So he was in there with a guy that was really good. The Volador match from Fantastic Mania 2019 is another one to go check out, the singles match with him. But, you know, he really got a stigma, dude, from that Sin Cara run with the American audience about, God, Sin Cara sucks, right? People were like, this guy just doesn't do anything. He's missing moves. He doesn't care. You know what I mean? And he kind of got that stigma. But now that he's back as Mystico and had a really good run, his confidence is way up, and he's in there and he's having a great time and is killing it, man. Go watch that guy. Go watch that guy in Arena Mexico in CMLL, and you're going to see a guy that is deserving of all the praise.
All right, and moving on to number 76 with 87 points. He was on Andretti and Mongoose's list. Mongoose had him at 54, and Andretti had him at 71, and that is Kevin Owens.
Yeah, very well-respected guy, man. Very trusted. I think that's probably what I kept coming back to when I was making my notes for Owens for this week. Trust. They keep going back to this guy because they trust this guy. You take a look at the Austin spot from WrestleMania from 2022. I don't even know what number they're on right now. I'm going by years at this point. But that the fact that they were the ones that they wanted working with Austin, and that Austin wanted to work with him, it just shows a level of respect and a level of professionalism and a level of trust that everybody acknowledges and is really comfortable with him. And that's a big deal, man. I mean, when you're bringing in people from the outside that maybe, you know, maybe they're celebrities or maybe they're people that haven't wrestled a really long time, that you have to make Steve Austin look strong, right? You got to make him look like he's the biggest ass kicker in the world. And the fact that Owens was in there selling and doing everything for him and making him look like $1 million, hats off to that guy, man. That might be his best accomplishment ever as a singles wrestler, is the fact that his performance against Austin in that match at WrestleMania was something that I think everybody's going to look back on that and be like, wow, what a great worker that guy really is. Underrated athleticism, I think, is another thing with him. You know, Vince always had a problem with the t-shirt thing. You know, maybe even broke some barriers with that. I don't know. Maybe he didn't, maybe he did. But the fact that the guy's been wearing a shirt, you know, all these years in the ring, I mean, nobody's done that. So nobody's really ever done that. So you've got a guy in there that's has kind of broken the mold a little bit with that. But I mean, Universal Champion. I mean, that's what it is, right? You go back and I watched that TLC match from 2020. You know, in the pandemic with the fake crowd, him and Reigns in that TLC match. Those guys were killing each other, man. That match was unbelievable. So, you know, the stuff he's done with Zayn is well documented over the course of time, you know, with him and, you know, the Ring of Honor run and being the indie darling all those years, then coming up and getting a big push in WWE. It's well-deserved. I mean, he's a hell of a worker, man. And he's a guy that everybody trusts and everybody wants to work with. And, you know, to get that level of respect from your peers and from promotions when you're in an industry that is physical, I think is an unbelievable vote of confidence for somebody. So hats off to that guy, man. I mean, he's somebody that is a future Hall of Famer, probably across the board. And I love watching him work. I don't love watching everybody work, you know, but when Kevin Owens comes out, I watch everything he does.
Yeah. I'm a little sad that I didn't put Kevin Owens on my list. I feel like, you know, like looking at my list, he's right around the 100 area for me. And I don't want to, and it's not for the fact that I don't like Kevin Owens or I don't think Kevin Owens is good. I didn't know where to put him. Like, should I put him high on my list? Should I put him in the middle? I didn't know. And I feel like there's more meat on the bone for Owens for him to climb. And I feel like if we do this list again, he's definitely going to be in my list. And Owens was one of the reasons why I started NXT in the first place, because him turning on Sami Zayn at that NXT show was one of the things that got me hooked back into wrestling. When I saw that, I was like, okay, I'm back. I want to watch that. I want to watch that guy. So I want to credit like that angle as getting me back into wrestling and caring about, you know, NXT and all that. So, you know, he's a Triple H guy. Like we already mentioned earlier in the show, he literally got handed that belt, that Universal Championship belt, because Triple H came out and pedigreed. I can't remember who was it. Dean, was it Ambrose? I can't remember anymore who he pedigreed. Was it Rollins? Yeah. I can't even remember. He pedigreed somebody and literally just handed that belt right to Owens. And that was on a Raw. So like, it's crazy that happened. And, but yeah, I like that. I really like Owens. He definitely deserves a spot on the list. I just was so torn on where to put him that I just didn't put him in there at all, which sucks on my part. So, but yeah, I mean, he's been all over the place. He was an indie darling. He's a Ring of Honor world champion whenever Ring of Honor mattered. You know, he was best brawler in Observer, in the Observer newsletter. He won best brawler from 2010 to 2012.
Yeah, 3 years in a row, 3 years straight.
Yeah, and he was in Feud of the Year with El Generico and or Sami Zayn. He was NXT champion, Universal champion, two-time Intercontinental champion, U.S. champion, Raw Tag Team champion, SmackDown champion, and he is the 16th Grand Slam champion.
The one thing I wanted to say here too, you know, I was looking through this list. I just want to put this promotion over because it's pretty fun to watch. North Shore Pro Wrestling. He was the North Shore Pro Wrestling champion one time. That is a Canadian promotion. It's a little French sometimes whenever you watch it, but if you can find those North Shore shows, all of those shows are fun to watch. So if you're looking, again, man, we're trying to just expand people's horizons, right? If you're looking for indie wrestling that is pretty damn good and fun to watch every show, go find North Shore. I believe it's on Fight. I believe it's on Fight Plus. I believe it is. But go find it, man. Go find that and check it out. That's a really fun indie promotion to check out.
Kevin Owens is in that interesting generation, sort of after WCW, where it was either your WWE or you're an indie guy. And he was top of the heap as an indie guy, worked, you know, with the Bucks, with Adam Cole, Sami Zayn, aka El Generico, and really made a name for himself and really made the indies hot with the work that he did. And then came a time where he made the jump to WWE and was kind of in that first class of black and gold brand folks who, you know, rose out of, you know, the perception that indie guys are not WWE guys and made it to the top in the WWE as well. Obviously, he went through NXT, was an NXT champion. He was a Triple H guy. Came to the main roster, was a Universal Champion, big storylines. He's a Triple Crown champion. He was recently just working with Sami Zayn again. They're on again, off again. But they're, you know, real life best friends or whatever. But I think, you know, I think the big endorsement here is that he was picked by Stone Cold to work at Mania with him. And while he's not a Vince kind of guy, he's believable and he can work with anybody. So definitely something to be said for Kevin Owens and his overall impact, sort of being in that forefront of moving from the indies through NXT to the main roster and succeeding there where others may not have. So I think Kevin Owens definitely deserves to be on the list, and he's still doing great work today. He's now on, he just got traded to SmackDown, and he's kind of working on his own again. So looking forward to see.
Yep. And moving on to number 75, we got coming in at 91 points. So we're finally starting to hit some higher numbers here. This guy was on everybody's list. I feel like this is one of the first times this is happening on the 100.
Yeah, he probably is. Is he the first guy that's gotten votes from all four of us?
I'm pretty sure he's a guy. Yeah, he's the only one so far. It took us to 75. It took us 25 deep to get into something that was on everybody's list. So this is a true entrant into the Podski 100. He comes in with 91 points. He was on Andretti's list at 84. He was on Mongoose's list at 100. He's on JC's list at 63. And he was on my list at 66. And that is none other than Scotty Steiner, Big Papa Pump. And I love Big Papa Pump. So I don't remember, because I'm a little bit of a younger guy. So I remember my introduction to the Big Bad Booty Daddy was whenever he came out at that Survivor Series in 2002, whenever they kept teasing back and forth that Steiner, was he going to join Raw or was he going to join SmackDown? And Steph and Eric were going back for trying, who was going to sign him. And he came out and beat the tar out of, I believe it was Dudley Boys, I think. But I love Steiner. That everybody will hate his WWE run. I'm here to tell you that it was fantastic. And the only thing that I would change about is that he actually got a WrestleMania match. And he should have got a WrestleMania match at 19 and or 20, but he should have got one and he didn't.
Well, give him one this year. We're going to be in Philly. Let's see it.
Yeah, give him one this year.
Get the sirens going to bring him out. Let's do it.
Seriously. He is a Hall of Famer in the WWE/F. I mean, he, as a singles guy, I mean, him coming out, when you go back, you look at his WCW run, did some awesome stuff with NWO whenever he finally turned heel and became a big singles guy, broke away from his brother, Rick. He, you know, comes out with a freaking tiger in late WCW. The dude is awesome. You know, who can't forget about Steiner Math in TNA, one of the greatest things of all time. And just, you know, a lot of people hate on that Royal Rumble 2000 match with Triple H, but that build, everything that they did in the build to that match was grade A professional wrestling. It just sucks that they gave an absolute stinker of a match because it was such a great build with every little thing that they did with the pose down, the bench press competition, the arm wrestling match, like that shit is so good. But yeah, I love Steiner. Super excited that he was the first guy on the list that was voted in by everybody. So hats off to Steiner.
I mean, dude, this guy is so awesome. He's so awesome.
This is what you
think. Dude, he's so awesome. I mean, look, I've always liked the Steiner. They're probably in my top three favorite tag teams ever. But you know, when you, it's just, I think part of that is just the goonery that goes on with these two jock meatheads that just beat everybody's ass, right? But the thing about him, dude, my favorite thing about Steiner is just the late stage WCW run when he's out there with the police sirens. And he's the champ, and this dude is unhinged on the mic, dude. And it, going back and watching that like late stage WCW stuff, man. I mean, it's not great to watch it, but when you go back and see it, it's just amazingly beautiful to watch this guy on the mic. And he's just off the chain, dude. He's off the chain with everything he does. Yeah. He's out there with the freaks, you know. It's unbelievable. It's him with the freaking the chain mail on his head, and it's the whole presentation of him, and he's saying crazy stuff. I mean, that is professional wrestling to me, man. It's one of my favorite things about pro wrestling is just that late stage WCW Steiner run when he was in there, when they were going down the toilet, circling the drain, and he's just out there just throwing heat every day, man. It's awesome.
Yeah. So in terms of accomplishments in the newsletter, he won best wrestling maneuver in 89 and 90 for this Frankensteiner. He had match of the year in 1991 with his brother Rick in the WCW New Japan Showdown. So definitely check out that match. That was with Kensei Suzuki that we mentioned earlier.
Sure.
He was tag team of the year in 1990 with his brother Rick. And he had the match that I mentioned earlier from Rumble 2003 with Triple H won worst worked match of the year for 2003. So I beg to differ, but that's just me.
Also, we have, you know, WCW World Heavyweight Champion, two-time television champion, two-time U.S. Heavyweight Champion, you know, seven-time tag team champ. You know, it's just an amazing list here, you know, with this guy for sure. I'm trying to see if there's anything else on here that really kind of jumps out. This would have been earlier. I was thinking like it was later, but, you know, two-time tag team champion, WWF, you know, with his brother. And then Hall of Fame guy too, you know, it's just amazing, dude. When you look at him, the tag team stuff early on, the early 90s tag team stuff is fantastic. The singles run, you know, down the road where he's just an unleashed character, man. It's just amazing. No other word for it, man, other than just, it's just so much fun to watch.
Yep. All right, coming in.
Actually, you know what? I want to say one more thing about Steiner. If you're looking for a match, a singles match, to go watch Fall Brawl 2000, him and Goldberg is one to go check out.
How can you have a list of the 100 greatest of all time and not have Scott Steiner on this thing, right? I mean, all the Steiner math and the ridiculous promos aside, you know, we're not talking about tag stuff, but obviously one half of one of the greatest tag teams of all time, whether that's in NWA or WCW. But as a single, he did great work with the NWO. Later, you know, kind of fully evolved into a top guy, you know, towards the end of WCW, had a WWE run, had a TNA run. And then his work, like, yeah, he's a big jacked up dude, but like could still pull off a Frankensteiner. And that was like the hottest of hot moves in its day. He's a Hall of Famer. He owned a Shoney's, you know, there's not much the man hasn't done, and he's still, ridiculous. And between the two brothers, apparently he is the, least onerous one. So ham cubes for life, bro.
Yep. Good one. All right. So coming in at 74 with 96 points. He was on Andretti's list at 88. He was on JC's list at 61. And he was on my list at 59. So kind of JC and I had him in the same area on our list. And that is Yokozuna. So I just felt that personally for myself, I felt that Yokozuna was one of the best original big men that I feel like needs to be showcased in the list.
Almost like a super big man.
Super heavyweight. Yeah. Like the way that he was able to move around and everything that he did, had some issues like late in his career, obviously, but was always at the top of the card. And especially like, you know, he was at WrestleMania 9 and had that match with Bret. And then, you know, that whole ending with that schmoz finish was pretty bland, but
it overshadowed an awesome match.
Right. It really did. I just feel like Yokozuna, like he's part of the Samoan family that we all know. I feel like he doesn't get the respect that he deserves mainly because, you know, it was in that dead time or the deader-ish time of WWF, and he was a super heavyweight. So, I mean, those guys don't always get the love that they should. But, you know, he was a two-time WWF champion. He went into the Hall of Fame in 2012. He won the 93 Rumble, and he was a two-time tag team champion with Owen Hart. So I just felt that Yokozuna should be on the list, and super happy that he made it.
That's pretty much what I had written down for him too. I had that he was just so much more athletic and so much stronger than he really gets credit for. His agility is unbelievable for his size.
You're a big guy, unreal.
Yeah, I mean, what an inspiration to people like me that are not, you know, slim. So, I mean, if Yoko can do it, maybe I can still do it. Who knows? But the story. I don't know if I have the details right about this, but I know the Undertaker had a funny story about Yokozuna and catering. It just slammed. I think it was Crab Rangoon's, that he was just slamming Crab Rangoon's all night, dude. And when I heard that story, I was driving in my car. I know I was, you know where I was? I was between Santa Clarita and Fillmore. I don't know what that road is right there. I don't even know why I was up there, but I was driving on the road whenever I heard Undertaker tell that story on a podcast or something. And I was laughing so damn hard, dude, because I was thinking, man, what a guy after my own heart. You know, he's sitting there crushing Crab Rangoon's. Dude, I would have given anything. I would give anything in the world to be at catering and just mauling down Crab Rangoon's with Yokozuna, dude. How much fun would that be? You just sit there and just take it all in and you're just smashing Crab Rangoon, dude. That'd be the greatest thing ever.
For real, it would be.
So I had for match for him. We talked about the Mania 9 match is awesome. It gets overlooked because of the stupidity at the end of it. But you know, he took him on again, right? A year later at 10?
At 10, yeah.
That match is really good. So I would go check that one out too. The Taker match at Survivor Series 94 is also really good. Oh, and you know what's fun? What's fun about that one too is that they're really close friends. The two of them are really close friends. And I think that always makes for a good match when you've got people in there that you know are really care about each other and they are friends, you know, they're friends off camera. So that's a really fun one to go check out too.
Yeah. Thing we didn't mention is he was a member of BSK, the Bone Street Crew.
So that's right. That's right.
Yoko's one of those guys that as I started getting into the new gen era, he just sticks out because he is so different, right? Just a completely different body style, completely different work. You know, and he felt like a huge threat. You know, the foreign menace gimmick is kind of played out and indicative of the era and maybe doesn't play in 2023. But what a presence. And he just felt genuinely scary, especially at a time where, you know, kayfabe may have still been at least a little bit of a thing with people. He just looked scary, right? So you can't, and he's part of the Samoan dynasty and, you know, was a champion, was a dominant champion for a stretch. And quite frankly, never should have lost to Hogan. So, Yokozuna, good number 74.
All right, coming in at number 73 with 99 points. We still haven't had anybody to eclipse 100 points yet. So he was on three of our four lists. He was on Andretti's at 50, had him ranked the highest. He was not on Mongoose's list. He was 84 on JC's list, and he was 70 on my list. And that is Bray Wyatt. So kind of a really sad story now that we're kind of going over this now. You know, Bray just recently passed away, but a guy that like is going to live on forever. There's not going to be a world where Bray Wyatt doesn't exist in the WWE. And, you know, coming in with that Wyatt family gimmick, like that Swamp family gimmick was unbelievable. It was so good. And, you know, the Fireflies, and then, you know, after he came back after being hurt and doing the Fiend, which a lot of people really connected with the Fiend, you know, basically if it wouldn't be for Bray Wyatt and Matt Hardy doing these, you know, the video matches, like those types of matches like that, like we wouldn't have the Undertaker getting his last match, or probably his best match that he's done in years. So, you know, the creativeness behind all of his gimmicks is just like, this guy was in a world and in a the world of professional wrestling that he probably shouldn't have been in. He probably should have been on like legitimate movies and television, but the guy just loved pro wrestling because, you know, obviously his dad was a professional wrestler in IRS. So, you know, the fact that, you know, we didn't get to see the full, you know, display of what this was going to be with The Fiend and Uncle Howdy and all that, a lot of starts and stops in there too, which sucks. And the fact that, you know, Vince put the kibosh on him a lot because he thought it was overweight. Again, another guy, like we talked about earlier with Kevin Owens, that Vince just didn't see enough in. And it just sucks that, you know, he's gone. But, you know, a guy that certainly deserves to be on the list, an incredible wrestling mind, in that, you know, one of the biggest highlights that I remember was him winning that title in Elimination Chamber. That was, you know, I felt like that was so much deserved. A guy that always ate the pins on a pay-per-view. I felt like this guy never won. I felt like the only time that guy ever won on a pay-per-view was that one, is when he won the title. But super decorated. He's won the, I mean, literally from the Observer, he won best gimmick in 2013 and 19. He won, I mean, so Dave didn't really like him. He got most overrated and worst gimmick in 2020 for worst overrated and gimmick, and 17 for worst gimmick with Sister Abigail. But he got a lot of bad stuff in that Fiend run, and it's because of the way it was booked, and it's not his fault, but a lot of the negativity that you see around Bray Wyatt is because of the Fiend, and it's not all his fault either. So
no, it's not his fault. But, you know, I really tried not to project whenever I was, or maybe forecast is a better word, whenever I did my rankings, but I had him at 50. In retrospect, now that's probably high. But I think you guys were probably right when you had him around, like you had him at 70, JC had him at 84. We've got him at 73 total. You know, probably about right where it's at. 50 is a little high, I think, right now, you know, looking at it. But for me, Wyatt is a guy that history is going to be very good to. When it's all said and done and we look back on this 10 years from now, I think it's going to be he's going to be a really important figure, and he's going to be beloved and really respected when you look back. History is going to be really favorable to Bray Wyatt, and I think it really should be. But I mean, look, there's been a couple people that we've talked about here where, you know, they just got the Vince curse, man, for whatever reason, and you know, they, one of the problems with WWE that they've had was that they go so far with things sometimes that there's nowhere to go anymore. They push it all the way to the limit, and then it's just done. There's nowhere to go. I mean, once you burn a guy alive and kill him in a match, like what the hell are you doing next? Right. There's nowhere to go after you do that. Right. But like you said, man, I mean, the creepy guy in the swamp that was the cult leader with the freaking lantern, if they just would have kept it as that and transitioned the Undertaker into him, and just let him be the next supernatural guy without all the stupid Fiend stuff. He should have been the guy that beat the Undertaker, man. He should have been the guy that break the streak. He should have been a guy like a Jake Roberts that never really needed a belt, but was always a threat and was always a big player. And I don't know why they lost the plot on that, but this, look, man, Jake Roberts is not a hell of a worker either, you know? I mean, and he was a guy that had a career for 70 years, you know, it seems like. But, I mean, this is – Bray Wyatt should have been that next guy. He should have been the guy that was able to work with anybody and could just be always a constant threat, maybe, you know, changing out the members of the family off and on, you know, here again over the course of time and just evolving it. But – I don't know why they did what they did with that guy, man, because they had something really special with him, and what a miss. What a miss. And so it's heartbreaking to think about that. I mean, this is a guy that seemed like a can't miss guy, you know, that they just missed, man. They missed. And the stuff with the red light, you know, and the Fiend, the crazy awful matches he had with Rollins. I mean, come on, dude. They killed this guy maybe deader than anybody. He was a main event guy, especially in a promotion that the wrestling wasn't always the focal point. He was a main event character that should have been a main event level guy for 20 years, dude. And they just dropped the ball with him, and it's really sad just to think about that.
Yeah, it is.
But that, you know, that the Danielson match from the Royal Rumble 2020, I believe that was a red light, correct?
Yeah, that was a red light.
If you can get past it, the match is good. So go check that one out if you want to check something out.
Bray Wyatt is one of those really interesting wrestling stories where the potential was always through the roof. You could see that he was a hot merch mover, wildly creative, right? And probably had two of the hottest gimmicks of the last 20 years, between the Swamp Cult Leader, Cape Fear character, and then The Fiend. Just the creativity that the guy had and the, you know, out-of-the-box thinking was, you know, unparalleled in his era. And when he was great, he was great. And then when the gimmick kind of ran its course, it ran its course. And I know some people don't like it. Some people do like it. It's, you know, it's flavors of ice cream. But the dude could seriously talk, could, you know, had a great idea for psychology, was a great sports entertainer, lost way too soon. It's a huge shame. And I think if there was ever going to be a successor to the ridiculously spooky but longevity of Undertaker, it was probably going to be Bray Wyatt. And it's a shame that we lost him so soon, because the potential was always through the roof.
Yep. All right. So moving on to 72, our final two remaining on the show, we have another guy that was on everybody's list here. That he came in at 48 on Andretti's list, 86 on Mongoose's list, 79 on JC's, and he came in at 92 on mine, and he had 99 points overall, and that is The Big Show. And I know that our friend, good friend of the show, Beautiful Bobby Winters, he's going to shut the show off at this point because he can't stand The Big Show. But just a guy that came in with an insane amount of charisma and, you know, literally won the title in WCW right away. First match, first night, like, and then career looks like it's going to be skyrocketed. Like, they build him as like Andre's son for a little bit. And then, you know, he takes like a big down swoop in WWE, like in those early 2000s. And then he makes a huge resurgence and he literally accomplishes everything in WWE. Just a guy that got himself into incredible shape in later years, now is working backstage with AEW, a super decorated guy that you can't discredit because of his, like, his resume is what you want from somebody that's done everything in the business.
Yeah, man, his list of accomplishments is incredible when you look back on it just on paper. But I mean, like you said, man, did he peak in his debut match? I mean, it's crazy to think about that, right? I mean, it's crazy to think about that. But, you know, the fact – another guy, you know, Hogan brought in. I mean, Hogan found the guy, brought him in. I never liked him in the NWO. I never thought that was the right fit. That whole – his whole NWO booking was just garbage. It was all garbage. I mean, my one of my favorite things about him is just him coming to the ring smoking heaters. I mean, the dude's out there smoking cigarettes during matches. It's unbelievable. Unbelievable. I love it. Loved every second of that. But, you know – the Dungeon of Doom stuff, I'm always going to love that. You know, the goofball stuff in wrestling, I'm a big sucker for that every time, you know. But the the Dungeon of Doom with him, and he's Andre's kid. I mean, dude, what are we doing, right? But it was just so awesome. It's so awesome. But, you know, that the late WCW run was terrible. And then he goes to WWF and gets a fresh coat of paint, and he comes in as a big star, and it just doesn't work. I don't know what happened. It just didn't work. But then he ended up, you know, like you said, having a really good run later on. But I mean, look, man, hats off to the guy. I mean, you know, 20-year career, 30-year career, you can't beat it. I mean, he you know, fed his family for 30 years off of pro wrestling. And he was treated like a pretty big star for most of that, you know, but you know, I don't know, man, was it something where we all overrated him? I don't know. Did he not grow the way we thought he was going to grow in a ring? I don't know. Maybe we all just overrated that guy from the get go. I don't know.
Yeah. And you know, for the Observer stuff, you know, he has a lot of the bad stuff that Dave likes to throw in there. But he, you know, he was Rookie of the Year in 96. So he was also the 12th Grand Slam champion, and he was the 24th Triple Crown champion in WWE. So like, the guy's literally done everything that you can think of in terms of WWE world. Like, he's done it all. So hats off to him.
Yeah. If you're looking for a match to watch with him, I mean, I got to say it. You got to go watch the Monster Truck Sumo match, Halloween Havoc 95, where they're on top of Cobo Hall, him and Hogan with the Monster Trucks welded together. It's so awesome. Go check that out.
Yeah, the other one that I think of too is whenever Brock Lesnar superplexed him off the top rope on a SmackDown in the ring, exploding. That's the first time that happened. I remember watching that when it aired live whenever I was a little kid. Like, I thought it was the greatest thing ever.
Awesome.
Yeah, good stuff.
Whether you knew him as the Giant, Big Show, Paul White, you know, whatever, however you knew him, I mean, you don't forget an act like him because of his just, humongous size, the look. I mean, he was a modern Andre, right? That's what he was supposed to be. And whether he panned out to be all of that or not, you know, that's for other people to decide. But, you know, in a time where there wasn't that guy early in his career, or there were people later in his career who were also huge people, I still think he was the most enduring. And yeah, you can complain about his flips and good guy this week, bad guy next week, blah, 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 blah. And that's booking. That's not necessarily him. You know, there was stuff in his early career guys his size shouldn't be able to do. Obviously, being that big takes its toll on his body much faster than someone smaller, and he had certain things. But, you know, in looking back at it, he was one of the early people who made John Cena for that U.S. title match back in the day. And I think part of his enduring legacy will be how much of a good guy he was behind the scenes. If you listen to some stories from people, he really took care of people early in their career. He was in a movie. He's Captain Insano. Who doesn't love a good Captain Insano gimmick? And really, who doesn't love the cigarette gimmick when he would come out in WCW smoking a cigarette? That gets me every time. So probably the most enduring big guy attraction since Andre.
All right, our final entrant for today. This is the first entrant to have scored over 100 points, and he is on everybody's list. And I'm going to let Andretti take this one away because I know that he loves this guy, but he comes.
Dude, I love Sid. I love Sid so much. So look, I had him at 55. Mongoose had him at 75. JC had him at 97. You had him at 75. But I'm honored to be the guy, the run point for Sid on the show. And I'm telling you, he's one of the meanest looking people in human history. This guy just looks like, holy shit, this guy. You can't ask for a better physical looking heel with just facials and body and size and strength than Sid Vicious, man. He looks like such an ass kicker, dude. And it's unreal. I was scared to death of this dude when I was a little kid. I was scared to death, man. When he joined the Horsemen, I was like, oh God, he's going to kill everybody now. He's going to be even scarier than he ever was, right? But I mean, I really love that. I love that WCW run with him too, where he was out there with that guy that was the judge, and they had the stretcher, and they were just power bombing fuckers all over the place, dude. Like, that was, it's so awesome to see that. Like, I was so, I was so into wrestling and so into ECW whenever that happened. And Sid shows up and the freaking place explodes and he's in there powerbombing dudes into a stretcher and they're carrying people out on a stretcher and on a gurney even, you know, not even a stretcher, it was a gurney. So it's just really great to see. But I mean, you know, greatest worker in the world, no. But when you look at just the physicality of this guy and just the presence of him is just, it's so just awesome. And he's so evil and he's so mean and he just looks like somebody that you just don't ever want to cross paths with. What an unbelievable heel this guy was, man. And again, like, you know, greatest wrestler in the ring. No, he's not, but he maximized what he did and he was able to get through it. And he worked really well with people that were super talented. Talking about Benoit, sold out 2000 versus Benoit. Awesome match. The stuff with Michaels. I mean, you can't ask for a better heel. You can't ask for a better villain for a babyface, man. This guy just an ass kicker. Awesome.
Yeah. And Sid, you know, he was a two-time WWF champion. He was world heavyweight champion in WCW. He's USWA Texas heavyweight champion. He was unified world heavyweight champion USWA as well. He gets a lot of shit from Dave. Dave does not like Sid, but I tell you what.
How can Dave not like Sid? I mean, it just by looking at this guy, how do you think he's not a main event heel? When he's going up against like freaking Shawn Michaels, he's a perfect guy for Michaels.
I know. I mean, I'm only saying Dave doesn't like him just because of he got most overrated and worst work match and all those. So but that's
what I don't know if those are Dave's rankings or are those the voter rankings.
Yeah.
I don't know. Either way, it doesn't matter. Either
way. Voter, but a guy that just oozes charisma and hell of a softball player as well.
Hell of a softball player. Yeah.
Sid had a look that, you know, it being so big, but also being absolutely just ripped up, looking like $1.5 trillion, kind of had a interesting promo style, that real intense, and then scraggly kind of voice, not scraggly, but like scrappy kind of voice that went with it. But the intensity with which he delivered those and the look that he had, it's really unique. He's definitely a Vince kind of guy. And he was also in WCW. He was heavyweight champion in both those organizations. And I think I sum it up best by saying he had warning track power as a wrestler, but man, he had all the hitting power in the world as a softball player.
All right. So that concludes the list today. That was 80 through 71. So we will be back in 2 weeks.
And we got some big names coming up here on the next one. So I was looking at the next list. It's going to be a lot of fun doing them.
Yeah, we got a big list. We got a big ones coming up. We got 70 through 61. So next week on the show, we're doing Hot Shots weeks 21 or 23 through and 24. And that's the penultimate episode of Hot Shots Wrestling Alliance. And then we're going into Hot Shots of Mania. So, you know, we've got a lot of great stuff coming up here on Opotsky. The Opotsky 100 is rocking and rolling. Once Hot Shots ends, we're going to be continuing with the rest of the list. We're going to count it down right to 100, and then we're going to do the Halloween award show thrown in there as well. So
yeah, we got something really special cooking for this week, and we're going to try to record it this week for the two finale. We're going to do a little football thing that I think is going to be really, really, really fun to record and really fun to listen to. I don't want to give any spoilers, but be on the lookout for that. We're going to drop the second episode of the two finale. It's going to be fantastic, man. I'm really looking forward to recording that later this week and hopefully getting that up maybe by the end of next week. Little high school football thing. It's going to be a big deal. It's going to be a lot of fun to check that out. So keep an eye out for that.
Yes. Keep a lookout for the two finale stuff. So make sure you check us out on all the socials at @_Podsky on Twitter and Instagram. Make sure you check out the YouTube channel. If you're watching us on YouTube right now, thank you. Make sure you drop a like and subscribe, and make sure you check out the Cambria County Coroner on Instagram. And with that, we will see you next time on the Podsky.